Black Box Podcast, BBOR, Black Box Online Radio, coming to you from West Virginia. Today we're going back to 2018, one of the more recent cases that we've covered on this channel, and we're talking about the assault of Kura Vidvik, the former NFL kicker, and I only say former because he is currently unsigned, currently a free agent. By the way, every sort of media outlet pronounces his first name differently. Sometimes they say Kara, Kura, one of them was even calling him Corey. That was one of the sports videos that was on YouTube. But I looked up the Norwegian pronunciation guide, and they were going with Kura. But, you know, I'm a West Virginian here, not too sharp with my Norwegian, so I'll just leave it at that. But the thing is, though, he's one of the few Norwegian nationals to be involved in any form of American professional sports, former kicker in the National Football League. And we're talking about an assault case that happened to him in 2018. According to a police report that was obtained by 11 News, and that's from WBLA-TV, that's WBaltimoreTV.com, and they were saying that Vidvik stayed out on a Friday night in Fells Point in Baltimore with some teammates before he split up with them and eventually ended up in shock trauma. Police were investigating the case as an assault, but many unanswered questions remained about what happened. And this was something that really stood out in the press coverage about this incident, because this is mostly a true crime channel, and I confess that this is a bit of a different case, but we have an assault that's taking place, you know, in the Baltimore area. No memory of what happened, and they really attribute that to the kind of head injuries that he sustained and intoxication, and there's a big thing we need to say about that. And the police report also stated that teammates left, but called Vidvik around 3 a.m., and he said he was good. Less than 3 hours later, he was at the hospital, and seems to have no memory of what happened. I was reading on a different site that his teammates had reported that he left with multiple women. I believe there were at least two women that he was kind of associated with during that evening, and he left with them. And that just brings us to kind of a lot of dangerous points coming together. I know it sounds very simple, but this guy was extremely lucky. I mean, some of the injuries that he sustained were all to the upper body, multiple lacerations to the face, required stitches. I mean, he was extremely lucky because we have two almost potentially life-threatening cases going on, and that's the reason why I wanted to talk about it today. The first one is just being intoxicated in Baltimore. I mean, they have this thing called the Inner Harbor, right? I mean, when you're intoxicated near a body of water, the risk of drowning is so much higher. Look at all the true crime theories that we've got surrounding these issues. The smiley face killers theory, the Manchester Canals pusher theory. We have cases like Henry McCabe, cases like Elisa Lam. All of these things are involving bodies of water, no matter how big or how small. The risk of drowning is just monumentally higher. And if he had been closer to any sort of waterfront, then the risk of drowning would have been just astronomical. But the thing is, though, you also have, like, another thing that's kind of a little bit more sinister. And I just wanted to point out, though, if there is this report that he was kind of leaving for the evening and he was kind of socializing with two women, nothing against them. I mean, I'm not implicating anyone, not trying to say that there are any sort of suspects in his specific assault case, but it is that it's just the concept of men and women work together to plan criminal activities, and it is so normal for women to lure people to a man who is going to do some sort of assaultive behavior. And I mean, it's just like the kind of Tinder murder we talked about recently, where some guy met a girl on Tinder, she invited him back to her apartment, and then her boyfriend came out and murdered him. That was a complete setup. You know, it's very, very calculated. It's a team effort. And things like that are probably going to be happening more frequently than we can expect. And it's very lucky that Vidvik was able to survive. And I mean, I do mean that in all seriousness. I mean, if you're going to be kind of lying face down or something on the streets of Baltimore, and you're to the point where you need stitches and you have no memory of what happened, then yes, you are very fortunate to survive. But there are countless instances of this, and sometimes it can even really get out of control even what we were just talking about with David Parker Ray recently on this channel, about how him and his girlfriend Cindy Hendy were luring women back to a trailer so David Parker Ray could torture them. And David Parker Ray was a serial killer, but we have no idea how many people he murdered. I mean, men and women work together in these team efforts, and I mean, once again, it's not necessarily to implicate those women in Kura Vedvik's Vedvik's assault, but it's, these things are very, very normal. So he was very fortunate with all of the kind of risky circumstances that were going on. And in a lot of the articles, they were quoting the Ravens coach Harbaugh when he was just saying that, you know, like, you just have to be grateful that he's okay, but the players need to stay out, like, earlier. They need to come back earlier, rather. And he said, a quote from his father, "My dad said, nothing good happens after midnight." And, of course, this was well after midnight. This was sometime between 3 a.m. and closer to around probably 4 or 5 a.m. because he was in the hospital just after 6 a.m. So you really see, though, it's just like, I mean, they're just kind of really just urging the players to stay in earlier. I guess we should say that. I don't know why that's such a hard sentence to get out. And at first when I read that, I thought, wow, that's a very extreme statement. I mean, they're like, you know, they're grown adults and you're saying that don't go out at night, don't go out after midnight and such. But in reality, if you're going to look at some of the things that we've been talking about, and the real thing, though, that Harbaugh was talking about was that he's saying that it was because he was alone and in a disoriented state. And that's really when we see the instances of people who are, you know, like dealing with the concepts of drowning and just dealing with the concepts of suffering a more serious injury. And when you're in a disoriented state, it doesn't even have to be from drinking. It could even just be like, say if he didn't touch a drop of alcohol the entire time, if he didn't just touch a single ounce of any form of drug or alcohol. I mean, what if he had just been assaulted? What if he just got into a fight with somebody and then, you know, he's lying down and then he was just, his own injuries caused the disorientation. We just mentioned the case of Elisa Lam on this recording. Well, I mean, they really believe that her disorientation was caused by bipolar disorder. And with other people, you can see that it's just, they get into a very angry argument with their significant other, and then they go off on their own by themselves, and that can even be the type of disorientation that is leading to these types of events. So it's just, you have all of these things coming together. And not to mention, there are people out there that are generally trying to lure you back to the kind of dungeon of darkness so they can kill you. And they come in all shapes and sizes, and they work together, and the world is this cruel, disgusting, nasty place. So, I mean, like, what really Harbaugh was just sort of saying was, be safe about it. It's not really telling grown adults that they shouldn't be going outside at night. It's more just like, be safe. And that was the message that he was delivering to the team, because, of course, their physical abilities are absolutely very, very relevant to football. But, of course, Vedvik, you know, had his stint with the New York Jets. And if you've followed anything in the NFL, you know how that went. And a lot of people really blamed him for the first loss against the Buffalo Bills. I mean, a lot of the fans, I mean, when you're just kind of reading, like, you know, what they have to say, missed an extra point, missed a field goal, he had his opportunity in the NFL, and that came after a very strong preseason in 2019 with the Baltimore Ravens. But, you know, the thing is, though, it's just, it's a cutthroat business in the National Football League. So many people don't make the cut, or they just get demoted to the practice squad and such, or they don't make it, and other people just don't really perform at the higher level. And Vedvik actually hit, what was it, a 92-yard punt when he was in college at Marshall. Yay, West Virginia, right? You know, got to represent the West Virginia schools in some way. But the thing is, though, in this particular incident, we've covered a lot of the bases about how it's connected to other forms of true crime, and I think that hopefully we can kind of tap into some other sports-related events in the true crime world. And I mean, there's another thing that I was kind of hesitant to talk about, and that was just all of the crimes that are kind of happening with sex workers and prostitutes. Because I know this is off on a tangent, but it's like, on this channel we mentioned so many times about how serial killers prey on prostitutes and sex workers, and I thought, well, why are we kind of focusing so much on the serial killer? Let's kind of focus on some of the kind of setup and some of the reasons why these things are happening to sex workers. And we just mentioned Cynthia Jaramillo on the channel recently, and she was the woman who escaped from David Parker Ray. And that's kind of a, you know, just off on a tangent, and I thought that that story was a lot better to present. But when you look at, like, cases, though, of sports-related true crime incidents, we can even get into conspiracy theories, talk about the sports industrial complex, talk about some of the more far-out things, like, that people are accusing the NFL of, especially the stuff with the Seattle Seahawks. And, you know, there are things that have been going on in other sports leagues. Say, for example, the NBA. Maybe you can think of something in basketball that's been going down like that. So the point is, though, true crime is a very kind of vast and expansive genre that we can really explore. And I think there are a lot of dark sides to just life in general. And, you know, it's just kind of like maintaining that balance that life is just kind of going through, about trying not to only be pulled to one side too much. And, I mean, you even see life's all about balance. That's why we have day and night. And according to Coach Harbaugh, nothing good happens after midnight or something. Apparently they're saying stay in the daylight or something, fear the dark. But, you know, when you're going to be just kind of living life, you can't always be afraid of the darkness. Sometimes you got to just plunge right in and just be like, just because for the sake of curiosity. But the way you do that is you don't go into it with any sort of disoriented state of mind. Now, I think, though, that this kind of case with Kura Vedvik is just something that we can kind of just kind of highlights some of the kind of examples of things that are going on with culture. And he was a very fortunate guy. But I think, though, that there are definitely going to be some sports crime cases that we can see they're going to blow things in somewhat of a different direction. The only one we've really done on this channel seriously was O.J. Simpson, but that's really focusing on things that he did after the NFL career. And, you know, it's like, that's just it's kind of just like a horrible shame, because, you know, he had a Hall of Fame career. And if you were just to get rid of the 1990s, forget all of that stuff, except maybe some of those, you know, like stuff he did with Leslie Nielsen or something, but then you would actually have something that you could really kind of capitalize on. Like, what about all of the NFL records and such? And then maybe his stint with the 49ers can be somewhat forgotten, but, I mean, well, you know the story. You know what happened. And we're definitely going to be covering some more of that, because we're getting a lot of new things that are coming in about OJ all the time. I guess, you know, I just been watching a lot of that stuff, so you always get some new things in the feed. But that's pretty much going to be coming to an end now, and I just think it's always a good chance to talk about sports a little bit, but this was kind of just a blend of everything, just a blend of every single possible dimension that we've covered on this channel in the past. And, you know, this is an assault case. And very few things would ever really lead to kind of solving it, but especially when the victim has no memory. But I just thought that it was just like, it was just kind of a different type of moment where someone just barely escaped all of those elements of darkness and destruction that we talked about. Well, that's all for me now. Until next time.